The CPIM today notes the judgment given by the Supreme Court regarding the Karnataka elections and the assembly. We think it's a positive development that they've asked for the floor test to be conducted tomorrow. And it'll be conducted by a pro tem speaker. And the floor test, we hope, will be conducted in an orderly fashion and a proper test is done and not through any other mechanism like voice vote or working out. A proper floor test is done. That is in the interest of Indian democracy and that is something that has to be established. We are glad that the effort by the BJP to try and indulge in horse trading by seeking a time of 15 days that the Honorable Governor of Karnataka had given, that the court has found as irregular and they have asked for this speedy establishment of the majority on the floor. And this is a positive development and we hope everything goes on orderly tomorrow. And our appeal to all the parties is that in a democracy, things will have to be tested on the basis of a majority and let that be tested in the newly elected Assembly of Karnataka. That is our first point as far as these elections are concerned. But as far as the situation in the country is concerned, we think that this Karnataka episode once again demonstrates the onslaught against parliamentary democracy and parliamentary institutions by this current BJP Modi-led government in the centre. Every institution of our parliamentary democracy is under siege. Parliament itself is not functioning properly. Never in the history of Parliament we have heard a no confidence motion moved by more than the required numbers is not taken up for discussion. Never have we seen a finance bill being passed which smuggles in various other legislations. And this is like including major changes in political funding, including changes in laws with retrospective effect, like the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act, so that the major parties, the BJP and the Congress, are beneficiaries of foreign funding to their parties in the past. All these are smuggled in the Parliament without 1 second of discussion. And they are muzzled through their majority in the Lok Sabha. So Parliament itself is being undermined. The judiciary, we have seen the controversies that have dogged the judiciary. We are seeing the other institutions that are coming under question marks, like some decisions of the Election Commission, the CAG, the institutions like the CBI, the Enforcement Department, the IB, Information Bureau, all these functioning directly with a very suspicious political objective in mind. So these are very dangerous things and the latest in this assault is the assault on federalism. The 15th Finance Commission, the terms of reference are actually yet another attack on the rights of the states. The GST has taken away one attack, has been one attack. Before that the VAT itself constituted a part of the attack. Now this Finance Commission, this is another assault. So we are asking all the non-BJP governments to come together to protest against this sort of an attack on the rights of the states. One initiative of the southern states was taken by the LDF government in Kerala. That has now expanded. I am told that there will be other non-BJP state governments also participating. So soon there is going to be a meeting of these people, we are informed, which is required in our country to strengthen the federal structure of our constitution, which is a fundamental feature of the Indian constitution according to the Supreme Court. Now, these attacks apart, we are finding in the country the sharpening of communal polarization has actually created a situation of an inhuman, it's a dehumanizing situation in our country. Young girls of 8 years old, 7 years old, gang raped, murdered. People who have to protect the rights of our individuals according to our constitution. They, section of them, are actually rising in support of the criminals. like it happened in the Kathua case when the lawyers rose in defense of those who committed the crime. So this sort of a thing is happening because of this sharpening of communal polarization that is taking place under this regime. And this is actually grievously injuring our country's unity and integrity. So on the one hand, you have economic burdens on the people growing. I don't know what is the price of petrol in Chennai, but it is the highest in our life that we have ever seen in Delhi, in other parts of the country. And when the international prices were falling, Indian prices were rising. Demonetization, GST on this price hike, and then the agony of the Indian farmer, the Annadata, as he's called. The number of suicides are increasing under this Modi government. The Modi government promised to give 1.5 times the production cost as the minimum support price. Now it has gone to the Supreme Court and said that is not possible. They had promised to give 2 crore additional jobs for our youth every year. Now they go to the Supreme Court and say that is not possible. So all these burdens on the people are mounting. Communal polarization is accelerating. Your attack on institutions of parliamentary democracy and democracy are deepening. So the situation is the time has come for the people in our country to rally together to oust this government in defense of India and our people. So that is the main call that the CPIM is given. We, along with other secular democratic forces, will join together in launching people's protests, and that process is on. Big struggles are taking place. They'll be more intensified in the coming days in order to protect the interests of the people and the unity integrity of our country. This in a nutshell is what I want to tell you. One thing, that old man raised it. You see, the idea is, our idea is that we, all the parties today that agree with this four-pronged approach, the four-pronged challenge before the country and the need to defeat these challenges. One is the growing economic burdens, 2, sharpening communal polarization, 3, authoritarian attacks on the institutions of parliamentary democracy and our constitutional authorities, and 4, the surrender of India and India's interests to the USA's strategic interests, which has very, very, very serious implications for millions of Indians working in many of these countries in the world. Now, on all these 4 issues, on the basis of an alternative, a policy alternative, all the parties that would agree, we are willing to cooperate. But the question is, forming of an all India alternative, that in Indian conditions, we've always maintained and I continue to maintain, in Indian conditions, an all-India platform or an all-India alternative will not emerge. Now, the United Front, remember in 1996, formed of the regional parties. That United Front was formed after elections, not before. The UPA in 2004, with Manmohan Singh as the Prime Minister, was formed after the elections, not before. So before the elections, you'll have regional arrangements, and that will cement together, and then on that basis, these dangers have to be faced and defeated. That is India. You must understand our diversity. It is not only giving a call and people will be right. In UP, for instance, what will either Telugu Desam or Telangana Rashtriya Samiti or the Trinamool Congress have any role to play? SP, BSP? In BJP, in the Bihar, it will be RJD plus the other forces there. So, the understand India, it got regional specificities. The people's protests are already going on. there are now, I mean, ongoing peasant struggles in our country, even after that long march to Mumbai that you have seen of the peasantry. A large number of organizations, I think about nearly 180 Kisan organizations and people's movements have all come together in what is called the Bhumi Bachao Andolan. And they are conducting the struggles all over. The struggles are already going on. Many of the working class sections, like the scheme workers, the Anganwadi, they are on the street in many parts of the country. The You see, no party in our country can take that sort of a role saying, I will unite the others. You will have to, in these specific states, specific regions, work out who are the people, on the basis of whom an alternative policy direction can be given. And those arrangements will be done region-wise, state-wise specifically. Karnataka developments are strengthened and will continue to strengthen first the objective of ousting this BJP-led government from the center. Second, for an alternative. In Karnataka, it's a different combination. In Andhra, it'll be a different combination. In Odisha, it'll be a different combination. In UP, it'll be a different combination. But these combinations will come. That it will encourage. And that will help in facing the general election to defeat these forces, which we think is absolutely imperative for the country and the people. I'm sorry? Yes. What will happen is, That is why, no, we have been on the streets opposing it. We have been opposing it. Parliament is not in session, otherwise we would have opposed it there. We have said that this is not only a backdoor entry, but this is directly facilitating foreign takeover of India's retail trade. Retail trade in India today employs, as an underestimate, at least 4 crore people directly. That means 1/4 of India's population is dependent on retail trade. Now, if that is taken over by foreign capital, then it will mean ruin for 1/4 of our country's population. And that was the exact objective of this GST. Ruin small-scale sector and allow the big corporate capital to take over. Demonetization. Ruin your informal sector and allow big corporate capital to take over. And all this is directly connected with allowing greater avenues for profit maximization for foreign capital. That is what this Modi government has been doing, against the interests of both India and the people. Crores. That is exactly what I was trying to tell you. They have made changes in the laws for political funding that will facilitate the BJP to amass greater and greater amounts of money. You have now what is called the electoral bonds. Nobody knows who is buying those bonds. Nobody knows who is encashing those bonds. All of us know the ruling party will get the maximum benefit of that. What this Modi government has done, it has actually doubled the rate of petty corruption. Earlier, 1,000 rupee note would do the job, now 2,000 rupee. And 2,000 rupee note is easier to pack and give it to people also, the quantum. So 100 crores, as they're saying, is not unbelievable. That's an allegation, all right, but it's not something unbelievable.
Thank you. approved the majority, then he will form the another party. But as far as the SR Bombay judgment concerned, they are saying different wording. What is your opinion?
This is not a hard and fast rule of calling the single largest party. There are innumerable precedents from the President of India to various governors. There is a 2-page big order issued given by President K.R. Narayanan in 1998 when the Vajpayee government was sworn in, ultimately, where he did not invite the Vajpayee government as the single largest party, because they had only 240 out of the required 272. He waited till the other, he could satisfy himself that they have a majority and then call them. This order is available in all the, on the website of the Rashtrapati Bhavan. Then you look at the governors appointed by this government. What happened in Goa? What happened in Manipur? What happened in Meghalaya? When the Congress take the claim as the single largest party, now, when they stake the claim as the single largest party, they were the single largest party. All the three governors said, no, you don't have a majority. Post-poll alliance has a majority, so they invited them to form the government. In Meghalaya, BJP was invited to form the government with only 2 MLAs. Now, these are governors appointed by the same government, under the same government. So the same yardstick, why has the Karnataka governor not followed? That was also not silent. That was not that they stake claim, they were told you don't have majority. Let me satisfy, the governor said, let us satisfy who has the majority. So post-poll alliances being called to form the government is the practice that has been perfected by this very government, central government. But when it doesn't suit them in Karnataka, they do the opposite. That is their political hypocrisy. That is their political bankruptcy.
So, regarding these legal arrangements deciding the national elections next year, are you concerned about your cadres supposedly coming to an understanding with BJP cadres in Madhya
No, our state committee there has completely denied that, saying that there is a wrong allegation and report. Yes, where they are facing attacks, what is happening in Bengal, remember, when you are attacked and when people are not allowed to go to submit their nomination or not allowed to go to cast their vote, whoever is there, whoever is fighting, they will be fighting. Then that doesn't mean there is any alliance or not. Whoever wants to fight will fight together. So, that has been squarely denied, rejected. There is no question. In Bengal, our slogan is, CPIM slogan, oust the Modi government to save India, oust the Mamata government to save Bengal. That is the slogan by which we are doing our work there. Well, we are trying, but there is a lot of, you please understand, there is a large amount of physical attacks on them. You see, whether it is now in Tripura or in Bengal. In Bengal, the politics is between Trinamool Congress and the BJP acting in tandem. Both are indulging in communal polarization, which suits both of them. And in the process, they want to deny space for left as well as other democratic forces. And it is that polarization that is going on. That is why in Bengal, a very famous slogan in Bengali is called Didi Bhai Modi Bhai. Didi is Mamata and Modi is Modi. So that is the politics that is happening. In the process, we are getting targeted. More than 46 people died in these local body elections now. The solution is that people's resistance is one solution. Is the main solution. People's response to defeat them democratically. Because all institutions are being misused by the powers that be. The State Election Commission in Bengal is completely at the behest of the state government. And what you see in Tripura, same sort of attacks against our party in Akada. So they are embarking on a situation where they want India without any opposition to the BJP. And by hook or crook, they want to create that situation. That won't be allowed. That is what has to be the people's response. That's what we are working to. That can happen only through strengthening popular struggles. Okay?
Yes. Hello, sir. Sir, tomorrow, Governor sir is conducting a performance meeting in Chennai. Why do you see him skipping from that?
I don't know. That they'll answer. I'm not aware of it.
இல்ல இல்ல அதாவது காவிரி பிரச்சனையில ஏற்கனவே மற்ற எதிர்கட்சிகள்லாம் ஒன்னா சேர்ந்து நீண்ட காலமா போராடிட்டு இருக்கோம். இதுல வந்து மத்திய சர்க்கார் பிஜேபி தான் நம்ம போராட வேண்டியிருக்கு. அதிமுக அரசாங்கம் மத்திய அரசாங்கத்தை வற்புறுத்தி நடவடிக்கை எடுக்கலன்னு நான் வந்து போராடிக்கிட்டு இருக்கிறோம். எல்லாரையும் கூட்டி வச்சு பேச வேண்டிய அவசியம் எங்க இருக்குன்னு எங்களுக்கு தெரியல. அது மட்டும் இல்லை, இன்னைக்கு திடீர்னு வந்திருக்கிற கமலஹாசன் ஏற்கனவே நீண்ட காலமா போராடிட்டு இருக்கிற அந்த கட்சிகள்லாம் இருக்கிற போது திடீர்னு இவர் வந்து கூப்பிட்டாக்கா அது எந்த என்ன என்ன நாளைக்கையில் என்ன கோரிக்கை வைப்பாங்க என்ன கோஷம் வைப்பாங்கிற அந்த மாதிரி எதுவுமே தெளிவில்லாத சூழ்நிலையில் ஏற்கனவே எதிர்கட்சிகள் ஒன்றா சேர்ந்து போராடிட்டு இருக்க இந்த பின்னணியில் அந்த கூட்டத்துக்கு போக வேண்டாம் என்று மார்க்சிஸ்ட் கம்யூனிஸ்ட் கட்சி தீர்மானித்திருக்கு.
சார், கமலஹாசன் வந்து தன்னைத்தானே
முன்னிலைப்படுத்துவதற்காக இருக்கலாம், அவர் அதுவும் ஒரு நோக்கமாக இருக்கலாம், கண்டிப்பாக அப்படி தான் இருக்கணும், வேறு வழி இல்லை. இல்லைன்னா இப்போ போய் எல்லா கட்சிகளையும் கூட்ட வேண்டிய அவசியம் அவருக்கு என்ன வந்தது? நான் அவரே பொறுத்தவரையில் காவிரி பிரச்சனையை பற்றி மதுரையில் அவர் முதல்ல கூட்டம் நடத்துகிற போது பேச்சுவார்த்தை மூலம் தீர்வு காணணும்னு முதல்ல சொன்னார். அப்படி சொல்கிறவர் நாங்கள் வந்து மேலாண்மை வாரியத்தை அமைக்கணும், உச்சநீதிமன்றம் வந்து ஒழுங்காக தீர்ப்பு சொல்லணும், மேலாண்மை அதிகாரம் கொண்ட ஆணையத்தை மத்திய சர்க்கார் அமைப்பதன் மூலம் தீர்வு காண வேண்டும். நம்ம எதிர்கட்சிகள்லாம் போராடிக்கிட்டு இருக்கிறோம். அவர் பேச்சுவார்த்தை நடத்தி தீர்வு காணணும்னு சொல்கிற ஒரு கூட்டத்துக்கு நம்ம எப்படி போக முடியும்? ஆகவே அவர் ஏதோ ஒரு முறையில் தன்னை முன்னிலைப்படுத்திக்கிற நோக்கம் இருக்கு தான் நினைக்க வேண்டியிருக்கு.
Thank you.